folks. I hope you're doing well today. We want to get started talking about logic. And the very first section in logic is discussing statements and quantifiers. We have several definitions in here and then some things to think about as we go along the way. So let's get started with our first definition, which is that of a statement. So a statement is a declarative sentence that is either true or false, but not both simultaneously. Okay, so we're gonna have some examples here where we decide whether we have a statement or not. But what's important about a statement is you can definitely determine whether it's true or false. So if you have something that's not determinable if it's true or false, then it is not a statement. So we're going to consider the first one. Text messages provide a means of communication. Now keep in mind, this is not whether you think it's true or false. It's whether it can be determined if it's true or false. And sure, text messages provide a means of communication. That is definitely a statement. What about 3 plus 11 equals 15? What do you think about that? Is that a statement or not? Well, it's a false statement, right? 3 plus 11 we know is 14, not 15. But the fact is, it can be determined whether it's true or false. And in this case, we can definitely determine whether it's true or false. So that is also a statement. So both of these so far, a statement. Access the file. What about the truth of access a file? Well, that's not a statement at all. I think you might all call that a command. Definitely not a statement. We can't decide if that's true or false. So that situation is a command. The next example, did the Braves win the World Series? Determine the fact that, I'm on the wrong page. Did the Braves win the World Series? Can we determine if that is true or false? Well, actually, that's just a question, right? So did the Braves win the World Series is definitely not a statement because it's a question. Any question is not considered a statement, okay? Next, Denzel Washington is a better actor than Jamie Foxx. Can we determine the truth of that? You might have your own thoughts about this, and those thoughts are called opinions, right? This is not a statement. Y'all, I'm trying to lose my voice here. This is not a statement. So Denzel Washington is a better actor than Jamie Foxx. It's just an opinion. That's all. It's not a statement. Next, this sentence is false. That's tricky because that seems like a statement. It's written like a statement. But you know what? This can be true and false simultaneously. It says it's false, but that could be a true statement, right? The fact that this sentence is false is a true statement. So you know what you have here? That's called a paradox. And anytime a statement is true and false simultaneously, it's not a statement. It's a paradox. And so that's what we have there. So there's a summary once again. The first one was a statement. The second one, anytime you have an equation, okay, where you know all the values, that's definitely a statement because you can determine the truth or the false of that statement. And then the other, a command, a question, opinion, and a paradox. So now it's time for another definition. A compound statement. Compound statement may be formed by combining two or more statements. The statements comprising the compound statements are called component statements. Connectives, such as and, or, not, and if then, can be used in forming compound statements. And you learned this in grammar, really, but now we're applying the same ideas to logic. So let's take a look at a few lines of information. Let's see if we can call this a compound statement or not. So decide whether each statement is compound. And here's the first one. Jing is younger than 18 years of age. Okay. And so is her boyfriend, Xu Fin. Keyword right there, and. Now, Jing is younger than 18 years of age. We got to make sure that is a statement. And it is. That's something that we can decide whether it's true or false. And so is her boyfriend, Xu Fin. We can also decide that if he is younger than 18 years of age. And it's combined by connective, okay, which is and. So, yeah, this is definitely a compound statement. Next, my brother got married in Copenhagen. What do you think about that? Is there anything compound about that? And I say there's not. I say that's just straight up a statement. You can determine if that's true or false, but there is no connective. You're not combining two different statements together, so that is not compound. Next, if Bobby is a politician, then Mitch is a crook. Okay, now again, it's not for us to decide if this is true or false, but it is definitely a compound statement. Why? You might not recognize this right off the bat, but this is a situation of if-then that is circled in the middle of our definition. So this is if Bobby is a politician, and Bobby is a politician is definitely a statement, then Mitch is a crook, and Mitch is a crook is definitely a statement. Not an opinion. I mean, you could tell if Mitch was a crook. If he's been convicted of something, then you could call him a crook. So definitely compound. Next, the sign on the back of the card read, Canada or bust. Now, I don't see any connectives going on here at all. I would say this is not a compound statement. Next, we have the idea of a negation. Now, the negation of a true statement is false. So if you have a true statement and you negate it, then it's false. And the negation of a false statement is true. So real simple. You're just changing the truth value of the statement. So we have some problems here. Write a negation for each statement. The first one is her cousin's name is Jason. So how could we negate this statement? If this is a true statement, then we make it false. Her cousin's name is not Jason. What do you think? Is that a good negation? Yeah, I think her cousin's name is not Jason definitely negates that statement. Now, it's not always so easy. Some of them can be very easy. Then it can be a little bit confusing. Let's carry on. The votes need to be counted. So what is the negation? So if this is a true statement, how can we make it false? Well, the votes do not need to be counted is what I would say. The votes do not need to be counted would negate this statement. Next, no rain fell in Greenville today. So what would negate that statement? How about some rain fell in Greenville today? So no rain fell. If you make that not true anymore, then some rain fell in Greenville today. Let's see if we can squeeze another one in here. Some people have all the luck. So picture this. If there are some people that have all the luck, then to negate that, I would think no people have all the luck, right? Now, I'll make a point here in blue. A negation must have the opposite truth value of the original statement. This is a reminder of how to think this. So the opposite truth value. So if some people have all the luck, then I would say no people have all the luck. That would negate that statement. Now, again, sometimes that can be a little bit confusing. And we will revisit that idea in a minute. But let's look at more mathematical expressions or statements that we can negate. So this is a reminder. I'm sure this is something that you learned in a previous algebra class. Not even an algebra class, but a math class. We know that on the left top line, that is read A is less than B. Okay, so A is less than B. Here you go. A is less than B. 4 is less than 9 is a true statement. 1/2 is less than 3/4. Just examples. Next is A is greater than B. Okay, 6 is greater than 2. Negative 5 is greater than negative 11. A is less than or equal to B. A is less than or equal to B. When you read it, the meaning, A is less than or equal to 10. 3 is less than or equal to 3. Remember, when you have the equal there, then you can have the same number on both sides. A is greater than or equal to B. Here you have negative 2 is greater than or equal to negative 3, and negative 5 is greater than or equal to negative 5. Just some examples there, just in case you're not comfortable with those, with that notation and symbols. Okay, let's do some problems with that. Give a negation of each inequality. Do not use a slash symbol. Okay, so you don't just put a line through it. Let me show you what I mean. So you're not allowed to say x, x is not less than or equal to negative 8. That's not allowed. So we are not doing anything like that. How could we express that as a negation? So if x is less than or equal to negative 8, then let's just think the negation. I don't want to say the opposite because that can get you in trouble sometimes. But what is not true? Now, you could draw that on a number line. Okay, here's negative 8. Not including negative 8, we're talking about over here. So if you're thinking about everything that negates that, you're talking about including 8 and everything to the right. Now, you could write that as x is greater than or equal to negative 8, couldn't you? Now, I wrote that where you could read it a lot better. Matter of fact, I typed it for you. But that is the negation of x is less than negative 8. You go the other way with it, and you also have to include the negative 8. So there you go. X is greater than or equal to negative 8. You ready to try this again? Here's the next one. X is greater than or equal to 11. So if I just picture this on a number line, so here's my number line. Here is 11. X is greater than or equal to 11 includes 11, and we're talking everything to the right, correct? So if we negate what we shaded in, that's going to be the opposite of what we shaded in, okay? So we're talking about open circle at 11 now and everything to the left. How do you write that down? X is less than 11, right? And again, I typed it for you so you could read it better. But that's the way to negate an inequality. And there's your x is less than 11. All right. Now, translating from symbols to words. And here's a reminder of the symbols for connectives. Matter of fact, I haven't introduced them yet, have I? So instead of saying the word and, we're going to use a symbol. It reminds me, if you'll remember back, it reminds me of the symbol I'm writing over here to the right. That was intersection. And it also used the word and. So when you're dealing with sets, use a different notation than when you're dealing with logic. But they still mean and. So and is kind of like that hat key or that caret key, whereas or is flipped upside down. Now, when we were dealing with sets, or was the union symbol, and it was like this. Notice how or is very similar when you're dealing with the connectives, and it's just that arrow upside down or the hat key upside down, that's often called. And then a negation is that tilde, so that curvy line like this, okay? Translating from symbols to words. It says, let P represent the statement, Abigail takes gymnastics. So P is Abigail takes gymnastics. I'm going to highlight it for us. There's P and Abigail takes gymnastics. And on the other hand, if you keep reading, it says Q represents the statement, Carolyn is an honor student. So here's Q and Carolyn is an honor student. Now we're supposed to translate each statement from symbols to words. We can do that. Here we go. It says P or Q. Now all the highlighting I've done is gone for you, but P or Q. So P is Abigail takes gymnastics. So that's, oh, and by the way, notice how I just said read, I said or right there. I read it for you. So Abigail takes gymnastics or Carolyn is an honor student. So there you go. That's how you translate those symbols into words. Let's try it again. Now, notice the tilde, the little curvy thing that means not P. And then you have the hat key, a true hat key, which means and Q. So how would I put this into words? Well, the not P means Abigail does not take gymnastics. Remember, you changed the truth of the statement. So if Abigail takes gymnastics is P, then Abigail does not take gymnastics is not P. And Carolyn is an honor student because we did not negate Q. So if I type that up, we have Abigail does not take gymnastics and Carolyn is an honor student. Feeling okay with this? So you just got to learn that the symbol, the first symbol up here, and, you have that caret, and then or is upside down. And again, it reminds me so much of intersection and union. Okay, got another one. Why don't you pause it and take a minute and see if you can write the expression for that one. Okay, you're back. What did you decide? So we have this negation out front, right? And then in parentheses, we could say, let's just read what's in parentheses first. So in parentheses, we have P, and then that's the or symbol, Q. So P is Abigail takes gymnastics, and Q is Carolyn is an honor student. So we could say Abigail takes gymnastics or Carolyn is an honor student. But then when we get negate it, you could say it is not the case that Abigail takes gymnastics or Carolyn is an honor student. So that is one way to do it. It is not the case that Carolyn takes gymnastics or, Abigail takes gymnastics or Carol is an honor student. Listen, another way to do it is Abigail does not take gymnastics nor is Carolyn an honor student. So neither of these things are true, okay? Abigail does not take gymnastics nor is Carolyn an honor student. That's almost a way to distribute it inside. But the first one makes it real clear just as it's written. Let's keep going. Now, why don't you pause it for a minute? Notice this is not the same problem. I had to look twice and go, hey, I just did this, but we didn't. This is a different problem. So take a minute, pause it, see if you can negate this statement on your own. All right, so we have inside the parentheses P and Q. So just that part by itself is Abigail takes gymnastics and Carolyn is an honor student. But if we negate that, we could say the negation in the front means it is not the case that Carolyn takes gymnastics and, I'm getting so messed up, I'm sorry. It is not the case that Abigail takes gymnastics and Carolyn is an honor student. So you're negating both of these things, okay? So it is not the case that both of these things are true, okay? So one of them could be true, actually, if you think about that. And there's a De Morgan's Law that goes with this. And we'll get to that point eventually. But right now, is the best thing to say it is not the case that Abigail takes gymnastics and Carolyn is an honor student. And of course, I have it typed up here for you. All right. If you hear all that bouncing around in the background, I do apologize. It's my dog driving all of us nuts. Now, quantifiers. Quantifiers are used to indicate how many cases of a particular situation exist. So the words all, each, every, and none are called universal quantifiers. So it's covering everything. Either everything is or nothing is. On the other hand, there's these things called existential quantifiers. And existential quantifiers like some, there exists, or for at least one. So you're just saying it can happen. There's an existence of at least one of these particular things. And negating universal quantifiers can be tricky. We want to talk about that. Consider the example, every month in the list has 31 days. So to discuss this, remember, we want to negate every month in the list has 31 days. That's overall the plan here. I just said consider the example. But let's think about the options. So if you were just going to make a list, what options do you have considering 31 days? Well, you could write a list for every month has 31 days. So for example, I don't know, January, right? March and May. All those have 31 days, right? But another thing to consider is you could make a list where some have 31 days and some don't. So you could go January, March, and June, for example, has 30 days and not 31, right? March, April, May, June, July. Yeah, I had to count it on my hands. Do you know that hand counting trick? Yeah, no, you can't see me right now, so I can't show it to you. But look up the hand counting trick for months if you don't know it. And then, or you use your knuckles. Anyway, so then you could have the possibilities of a list where none of them have 31 days, right? So for instance, you could have February on the list. April doesn't have 31 days. What's another month? June. We'd already discussed that one. Okay, so all have 31 days in this case. Some have 31 days in this case, and none have 31 days in this case. So when you're thinking about all the possibilities of making lists, talking about 31 days, those are all the options, right? So that's something that you need to think of if you were going to negate this situation. So if we are going to negate it, We could say no months in the list have 31 days. Now, remember my examples over here. Let me back up. There they are. So this is every month in the list have 31 days. We know that the first one definitely does not negate it, right? Because this is the truth right here. These two situations would negate it. So if I go back to my list and say no months in the list have 31 days, that was my third option. Well, y'all, that can't be the negation because it leaves out the situation where some do and some don't. So we're going to cross through that and go, no, that doesn't work. No months in the list have 31 days. That partially negates it, but not entirely. So let's consider every month in the list does not have 31 days. Again, that's the same as saying the line before. If you say every month in the list does not have 31 days, that's that third line when you're just talking about February and April and June. But again, what about the list that some have 31 and some do? Because that's still not the same thing as every month in the list has 31 days. That should be part of your negation. So that option is out as well. So how do we say this? Well, what about some months in the list do not have 31 days? That picks up those other two. If I go back to my list, look at this line. We knew that these two have to be part of the negation, right? Because anything that makes this not true are these two. Now, this definitely includes some months in the list do not have 31 days, and so does this. Some months in this list do not have 31 days. Turns out all of them in the list do not have 31 days, but that's still included in some of them in the list. So if I go back where we are, right here, some months in the list do not have 31 days. That's definitely a valid negation. That's not the only way to write it. Another way is not every month in the list has 31 days, right? If you're saying the negation of every, then some or not every is going to work. And then another way, it is not the case that every month in the list has 31 days. That works out too. That's not all. You could also say at least one month in the list does not have 31 days. I like that one a lot. So is there one way to do it? Clearly not, because we've got four different options here. And they're all correct, but you've got to be really careful when you negate quantifiers. But I have some hints for you. So here we go. If you have the statement all do, then a negation of that would be some do not. And that's the example that we just did. It said every month in the list has 31 days. That's all do. So you could say some months in the list do not have 31 days. If we would have had this before we got started, we would have knocked it out in no time, right? And then if you're considering some do, then the negation of that is none do. And you may have to refer back to this as you're doing these homework problems because this can get tricky. Let's do an example. So some cats have fleas. We're trying to negate this. It says form the negation of each statement. How could we do this? Some cats have fleas. Notice this is a some situation. So what if we said no cats have fleas? That is the negation of some. So no cats have fleas. What did I type? Yes, no cats have fleas. There you go. Does that make sense? What did I do? I went to the some do line and read what the negation was and just applied it to that problem. Let's try it again. Some cats do not have fleas. Why don't you pause it and think about that for a minute? Now, did you figure it out? It makes me want to write it down. So some cats do not have fleas. I could say all cats. So some, no, wait, oh, my bad, not all. Some cats do not have fleas, none. So no cats do not have fleas. Now, wait a minute. No cats do not have fleas. That's a whole lot of negatives, right? Is that not the same thing as all cats have fleas? If no cats do not have fleas, to me, that's exactly the same thing as all cats have fleas. If you have no cats that don't have fleas, doesn't that mean every single cat has a flea? Or two? Or 100? Yes, yes, yes. That's the same thing as all cats have fleas. So again, you have to think about these really hard. Let's try another one. You want to? Okay, no cats have fleas. Okay, pause it. See if you can figure out how to negate that statement. Did you think through this tricky mess? Again, no cats have fleas. That's very similar to saying all do. Notice none is not on this list, but it is a universal quantifier because it's talking about every one of them. So all do, that means some don't. If you thought no cats have fleas, then the negation of that is all cats have fleas. Then you're leaving off the idea that the negation is the opposite true statement of that is that some of them do. So some cats have fleas would negate this statement. And again, if this is driving you nuts, I do understand, but I want you to think about it. You're thinking about everything that makes this not true. And when you say no cats have fleas, that means there is not a single cat that has any fleas. And so the negation of that, it doesn't mean every one of them has fleas. It means that one of those blasted cats has a flea. You see what I'm saying? So at least one cat has fleas or some cats have fleas. Either one of those is correct. Again, I understand if that's confusing. You have to think through it. And please go back to this. I think that helps a lot. There's nothing on this list that talks about none, but that's the same as all. So it's a universal quantifier. It's including everything. Now, we've talked about sets of numbers. We talked about sets of numbers when we were dealing with sets, which is a good place for it. And I want to include them again. You know, the natural numbers are the counting numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, all the way forever. Whole numbers is the same list, but it includes zero. Integers is the same as the whole numbers, but we include positive and negative values. Rational numbers are fractions. P over Q, as long as Q is not equal to zero, you have a fraction. Real numbers. I took a little bit of an issue with this definition of real numbers. This is straight out of your book. To me, a real number definition is all the rational and irrational numbers in one set. This book defines it differently. It says X, all the X's, such that X is a number that can be written as a decimal. I do think that's lacking a little bit because it could be an infinite decimal. What do I mean by that? I mean that the decimal goes on forever and ever and ever and ever, like the number pi, which in my mind is not exactly a decimal, and we could get into the ins and outs of this definition. I don't want to take it too far, but I'm just going to leave it as the book has it. And then irrational numbers, X is a real number, and X cannot be written as a quotient of integers. In other words, it's not rational. You can't write it as a fraction. So that makes up all of the numbers that we know, where the real numbers is really the biggest set, because real numbers include these guys and these guys. And all of these fit in here somewhere. Okay, now let's answer a few questions about this and call this video done. Now, decide whether each statement involving a quantifier is true or false. I'm going to write small here. Okay, there exists a whole number that is not a natural number. Now, if we can find one, then we could say this is true. If there is not one, then we would probably need to say this is false. So, is there a whole number that is not a natural number? What do you think? Well, let's go look at your list. Look at the natural numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, forever. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, forever. What about X equal to 0? Right? There does exist a whole number that is not a natural number. So this is a true statement. We can say that for fact because we found one, and that makes it very true. All right, let's try this again. Every integer is a natural number. What do you think about that? Every integer is a natural number. Let's look at all the integers. Negative 3, negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, 3. But let's look at the natural numbers. Well, looks like to me, x equals 3, or negative 3, I'm sorry, is not natural. And what we found here is what's called a counterexample. This is a false statement because we were able to find an integer that is not a natural number. There's an infinite amount of them, but we found one. And again, that's called a counterexample. So that's a false statement. Let's keep going. Every natural number is a rational number. So let's look at our list of natural numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, forever. And then our rational numbers, remember, rational numbers is just a fancy way of saying you have a fraction. Now, the natural numbers, are they fractions? Because it's basically saying every natural number is a rational number, so every natural number is a fraction. Are they fractions? You might not think so, but look, 1, you could write as 1 over 1. 2 you could write as 2 over 1, 3 you could write as 3 over 1, 4 you could write as 4 over 1, and you could keep going. By the way, that's not the only way to write 4. I could write it as 8 over 2, right? Yes, every natural number is definitely a rational number, and so this is a true statement, because we are able to write every one of them. Even though we didn't write every one of them, it is possible. And then the last question in the video, period. There exists an irrational number that is not real. Now, I think you caught me when I said the real number, the definition of real numbers that I know is the rational numbers combined with the irrational numbers. So that was a little hint right there of how to handle this one. But there does not exist an irrational number that is not real. It's impossible. An irrational number is a real number, okay? And if we use these definitions up here, x is a real number, and x cannot be written as a quotient of integers, but it can be written as an infinite decimal. So their definitions don't clue you in quite as much, but there exists an irrational number that is not real as false. You can't find one. That, I think, is the hardest one in the list, because you would have to think about a counterexample for that, but you just can't. A number that's not real is what we call an imaginary number, and we won't be talking about those in this class at all. All right, that wraps it up. So all about statements and quantifiers. Negation really is the hardest part of this, and learning the symbols. So if I recap, remember this symbol is or, this symbol is and then this symbol is red. You could read it as not or the negation symbol. I hope you have a wonderful day.